In January 1879, the British Empire had gone to war with the independent Zulu Kingdom. The British had entered the war convinced of their military superiority and the righteousness of their cause. But just 11 days into the campaign, they had suffered the worst military disaster of Queen Victoria's reign here at Isandlwana. Over 1,300 British troops and their African allies were killed, and the survivors chased ignominiously out of Zululand. Even the successful defense of the border post at Rorke's Drift, which followed the disaster, could not obscure the fact that the British strategy was in tatters. News of the defeat reverberated around the empire, and troops were hurried to southern Africa to restore British prestige. The Zulu people were characterized in the world's press as savages, implausibly ferocious warriors who, like Africa itself, needed to be tamed in the name of civilization. The British Empire cried out for revenge. For British troops elsewhere in Zululand, the collapse at Isandlwana shattered the easy confidence with which they had begun the war. Two British columns remained in the field, suddenly isolated by the destruction of the center column, and suddenly vulnerable themselves. On January the 23rd, a column of 3,000 men under the command of Colonel Charles Pearson had occupied the deserted Norwegian mission station at Eshawe. On the 25th, sentries at Eshawe heard the Zulus spreading the news of Isandlwana from hilltop to hilltop. Confirmation came 3 days later.
The news of Isandlwana left Pearson in a quandary. Lord Chelmsford had left the decision up to Pearson as to whether he stayed put at Eshawe or whether it was safer to retire at the Tukela. Pearson considered his options. If he remained at Eshawe, he could risk being attacked by the entire Zulu army with no chance of any support. But if he retreated to the border, he could be caught in the open and attacked and suffer a defeat as crushing as that which had hit Durnford and Pullain at Isandlwana. Furthermore, Pearson feared the effect on the morale it would have for the Zulus if the British were forced to retreat. He therefore called a council of war and discussed the situation with his officers, and they eventually decided that the best option would be to stay put, to dig in and make the position as strong defensively as possible, hoping that they could then remain a thorn in the Zulu side until help was able to come and rescue them.
We left the mission church standing intact in the centre, which was turned into a hospital, and the tower to be used for the crack shots or marksmen to fire from through holes cut in the brickwork for that purpose. Round the fort, a trench was dug about 12 feet deep and 20 feet wide. At the bottom of the trench, sharp, pointed stakes were driven in, so that if the Zulus made a rush at us, they would have found themselves falling upon the spikes. Outside the trench, small holes were dug, and sharpened stakes were placed in the centre of each hole, and wire was stretched over the holes in all directions, so that persons moving in the dark would stumble and give an alarm. Inside the fort, high mounds were thrown up as a protection from crossfire, so that altogether our position was almost impregnable.
Pearson's decision to remain at Eshawe was a deliberate gesture of defiance, and it was not lost on the Zulu king.
The general opinion is that King will bring down his whole army and try and storm it. He is indignant that Colonel Pearson should presume to settle himself down permanently in the middle of his country, as if it was already conquered. He will make the attempt to turn him out, even if the trenches have to be filled with dead bodies to make an inroad in.
Yet in the aftermath of Rorke's Drift, King Cetshwayo's strategy was more sophisticated than this.
King Cetshwayo was quite reluctant to allow his warriors to attack a defended position in the open. Certainly Rorke's Drift had shown the disadvantages of that. And instead he instructed his men living in the coastal regions to muster at the royal homestead surrounding Eshawe. From there, they sent a screen of scouts out which watched the British movements on a daily basis, and there was a deliberate attempt to provoke the British, firing on their cattle parties, firing on their patrols. in the hope of drawing them away from the defended positions, when the Zulus could then attack them in the open and, as they thought, repeat the successes that they'd gained at Isandlwana.
To our dismay, we discovered we were completely hemmed in by the enemy. Neither troops nor convoys could come up country until a relief could be spared. No sooner was this discovery made than we were put on half rations, consisting each day of a pound and a half of inconsumable beef, 6 ounces of biscuit, 6 ounces of flour, a little coffee and tea, sometimes none at all, half an ounce of sugar, no salt or pepper, a little lime juice without sugar, no vegetables except what we could forage. Worst of all, no tobacco.
If Pearson's garrison was safe enough within the fort, however, the isolation and boredom soon preyed on the men's nerves.
Often a few natives might be seen in the distance. Sometimes our marksmen might have a shot at them, for our rifles could reach them while theirs would not carry to us. Sometimes the tables were turned, and frequently our mounted outposts would be attacked by Zulus, who crept up to them under the cover of long grass. One poor fellow rode back to the fort with more than a dozen wounds. How he managed to keep his seat and fight his way through the enemy, I cannot tell. Those who fell into the hands of the enemy were terribly mutilated and left on the open ground to be found by their comrades the following day.
There were more insidious dangers inside the fort, too.
Pearson feared that a disease could take a hold in these cramped and insanitary conditions, and he did everything he could to keep it at bay. But the nearby streams became polluted, and very soon disease took a hold on the garrison.
Time wore on wearily, and soon the men were falling fast from typhoid fever, which broke out among us. We got quite used to following a comrade to his last resting place. The poor fellows who died were rolled in their blankets and lowered into the grave, without a shot being fired over them, for fear of wasting ammunition.
Now, it could be argued in many respects that the Zulu strategy at Ishawi was a far more effective use of resources than, say, a major campaign like Isandlwana. There, a Zulu army had made a frontal attack on a British column and had largely destroyed a very important part of it, but in doing so they'd suffered a huge amount of casualties.
Within about a week of Pearson's command arrival at Ishawi, the Zulus had effectively cut the road back to the border, thereby preventing any further communication by runner. From the hills just to the south of the fort, it was possible for the men of the Ishawi garrison to just about make out the Tukela border some 30 miles away. Both British garrisons attempted to open communications, and Pearson's senior engineer officer, Captain Wynne, came up with a number of inventive ideas. In the end, it was the garrison at the Tukela who first opened communications by utilising a bedroom mirror they acquired from a nearby hotel, which they managed to flash signals via Morse code to the garrison at Ishawi, but this only worked when the sun shone.
For some days, a flashing was noticed in the sky in the direction of the drift, so one of our officers contrived to make an apparatus out of some biscuit tins and a piece of iron pipe with which to reply. They must have seen our flash signal at the Tugela drift, for different numbers of words began to be distinguished by our men. At last, after fearful anxiety, a message came to say the troops had landed at Port Natal, were on the march to our relief.
In the aftermath of the Zulu victory at Isandlwana, pretty much the whole of the Natal border had been wide open for a Zulu counter-attack. Yet the reality was that the Zulus had been exhausted by their victory in that battle. It was necessary for the men to disperse and to recover and go through various post-combat rituals to cleanse themselves of the ill effects of fighting in that particular battle. And so although the strategic advantage had lain very much with the Zulu king Cetshwayo, he wasn't physically able to exploit it at that period. That, in a sense, allowed the initiative to slip to the British, and reinforcements were then rushed into South Africa. And of course, Lord Chelmsford was then in a position to regroup and to mount a fresh assault to retrieve Pearson's column besieged at Ishawi, without the Zulus first gaining any advantage from their earlier victory.
Lord Chelmsford was determined not to repeat the mistakes of the Isandlwana campaign, when he had clearly underestimated the abilities of the Zulu army. During the Ishawi relief expedition, he adopted the traditional Boer laager defence system, which involved drawing the wagons together to form a tight defensive barricade at the end of each day's march. Whereas the Boers had favoured a traditional circular defence, Chelmsford chose a more easily manageable square formation. So at the end of each day's march, the wagons would be lagered, and then a shelter trench would be dug about 15 yards outside the wagons. The earth from this trench would be piled up just inside to form a rampart. All the transport oxen would be driven inside for their own protection. And when the stand to was sounded, all the men would line the rampart three or four deep. Once in position, this was a very effective defensive formation.
It was very clear to the Zulu scouts that the British were mustering a fresh column on the Tugela River. Their response was to muster between the Enyazan hills and the border, very much blocking the road between Ishawi and the point where Lord Chelmsford would begin his march to relief. There were possibly about 12,000 Zulus from various Amabuto, mostly men living in the coastal districts, who camped in the foothills of the Enyazan Heights just below Ishawi, waiting for Lord Chelmsford to advance, in the hope actually of destroying the British column before it made the final ascent of the hills to relieve Ishawi.
On the 1st of April, Chelmsford camped on an open rise known as Kwagingenglovu, near the Inyazani River. It was a wet night, and the following dawn brought with it an awesome sight.
About 6 o'clock on Wednesday morning, the 2nd of April, a shout ran round our entrenchment, "Stand to your arms!" The bugle sounded the alarm, and everyone bounded into his place. Close by me was one of our natives, his eyes fixed with the look of a hawk, while with one hand he pointed towards the Inyazane Valley and said to me, "Impi." It was a Zulu army.
For many of those inside the British square, who had not yet seen the Zulus in action, the sight of their approach was mesmerizing.
They surrounded us. Then began the most splendid piece of skirmishing I ever beheld. No whites ever did or ever could skirmish in the magnificent perfection of the Zulus. Unencumbered by much clothing, in the prime of life and as brave as possible for any man to be, they bounded forward towards us from all sides, rushing from cover to cover, gliding like snakes through the grass, and turning to good account every bush, every mound, every particularly high patch of grass between us and them, and firing upon us, always from concealment.
Yet Chelmsford had learned the lesson of Isandlwana well. There were no gaps in the British square at Gingindlovu.
Once it was clear that the Zulu attack had run its course, Lord Chelmsford ordered his cavalry out to turn the Zulu retreat into a rout. The British pursuit was ruthless. Any fleeing Zulus the mounted men came across were instantly cut down, and no quarter was given. The British had felt a very real need for revenge after Isandlwana. The Zulus rarely took prisoners and had killed everyone they encountered at that battle, and this had preyed on the minds of all those campaigning in Zululand. After Gingindlovu, many men felt a great sense of relief, and some confidence was restored to those who had been haunted by the destruction at Isandlwana.
Their bravest men had not breath to run away, and they perished. Let me draw a veil over that last part of the scene. Chivalry ends when pursuit begins, but the dire necessities of war oblige that a defeated army shall also be dispersed so that it shall never fight again. It is called consummating the victory. All the bodies within 1,000 yards of us were ordered to be buried at once, and they numbered 471. Such fine fellows, Herculean limbs and high, intelligent foreheads. But the British public's notion of Zulus is its notion of all black races, and that notion is of the savage.
The battle had been clearly visible to Pearson's men.
All day long we were waiting patiently for the long-expected assistance. At last, about 9 o'clock at night, we heard the bagpipes of the 91st Highlanders. On they came, playing the Campbells Are Coming. Cheer upon cheer resounded in the still night. And when our friends arrived, the first question from the Ishawe garrison was, "Have you got any tobacco?" Oh, that smoke. I do not think any of our men will ever forget it.
Even before Lord Chelmsford had relieved Ishawe, he'd taken the strategic decision not to hold the post. As far as he was concerned, it was far too vulnerable to any kind of Zulu counterattack. It was simply too far into Zulu territory. And his idea was to withdraw from Ishawi much closer to the border, and then as further reinforcements came in, he would be able to build up a whole new invasion force. This was, of course, a view that greatly disappointed Pearson's men who'd endured the siege. They'd been for 3 months under very difficult circumstances, and they had at least hoped that when Chelmsford arrived, the position that they'd held would be secure. In fact, of course, Chelmsford decided to completely reorganise his force and to set in motion two very different columns to invade Zululand, actually in a much improved version of his initial invasion strategy from several months before.
By the middle of April, Chelmsford's troops were largely back at the border, exactly where he had started 4 months before. Yet the underlying reality of the war was very different.
The British were now in a position to replan a whole new offensive, and Lord Chelmsford formed a new column down on the coast from the remains of Pearson's men and the Ishawi relief column, which was called the 1st Division. The idea was to advance up the coast, much as Pearson's column had done. And a new column consisting entirely of reinforcements was to move through the centre of the country just north of Rorke's Drift. This was called the 2nd Division.
Throughout May, British reinforcements assembled on the borders. Yet before the new invasion could begin, the ghosts of January had to be laid to rest.
Lord Chelmsford had been the subject of a certain amount of criticism for the fact that since the Battle of Isandlwana he'd made no attempt to bury the dead. In fact, he'd been very wary of moving so far into Zululand in the aftermath of the defeat, simply because he feared a Zulu counterattack. However, with a new invasion brewing, it was necessary actually to recover a lot of the viable military equipment that was still lying out on the battlefield. In particular, he needed the transport wagons, and that provided the opportunity for a limited burial of many of the British dead that were still lying out on the battlefield.
There was none of the stark, blood-curdling horror of a recent battlefield. A strange dead calm reigned in this solitude of nature. Grain had grown luxuriantly round the wagons, sprouting from the seed that had dropped from the loads, and so long in most places had grown the grass that it mercifully shrouded the dead, whom for long months tomorrow we had left unburied. As one strayed aimlessly about, one stumbled in the grass over skeletons that rattled to the touch. In a patch of long grass near the flank of the camp lay Colonel Durnford's body, the long moustache still clinging to the withered skin of the face.
By the end of May, the new columns were in position. That a new British offensive was imminent was obvious enough to the Zulu scouts who watched the border. On the 1st of June, the 2nd Division crossed into Zulu territory, and the new invasion began. And immediately there was a fresh and entirely unexpected disaster for the British.
The Prince Imperial arrived in the aftermath of Lord Chelmsford's victory at Gingindlovu. Chelmsford really must have been questioning his luck by this point. He's in the middle of this extremely difficult campaign. It started very badly. He's now at last turning it to his advantage. And suddenly he's saddled with a celebrity tourist who's been dumped on him by the authorities back home. The prince, of course, was the last legitimate heir to the Bonaparte throne in France, and he'd fetched up in the United Kingdom by a very strange series of circumstances. Chiefly, the imperial family had been chased out of France during the Franco-Prussian War in 1870, and the young prince had been allowed to train as a British officer. When the Zulu War broke out, he'd managed to wangle an attachment to Lord Chelmsford's staff, but had gone out to Zululand without any official rank and with no official standing. This was surely exactly what Lord Chelmsford didn't need at this stage of the war. And what's more, the Prince Imperial turned out to be quite reckless. When scouting parties were sent out to prepare for the new invasion routes, the prince had ridden out several times and very nearly got himself into trouble by his propensity to chase after Zulu scouts waving his great uncle's sword. On the 1st of June 1879, there's very clear evidence that he was allowed to go out on patrol ahead of the British advancing column, really as a jaunt. He'd been left in camp, he hadn't seen much action over the previous days, and his military superiors seemed to have felt that, well, here was an opportunity without risk to allow him to see something of real soldiery. In the light of subsequent events that happened, one can really only point the finger at the Prince Imperial himself for having got himself into this situation.
The patrol had stopped to rest at a deserted Zulu homestead several miles ahead of the column. It was a hot day, and the prince dozed in the shade. No sentries were posted, and the escort's guns were not loaded.
We were watching as a scout, and we saw the white men coming late in the afternoon. When we got near to them, we fired many shots, but they all missed. Four white men had already mounted, and these escaped.
but the other three and the dressed native had not yet mounted. The prince was in the act of mounting when his horse threw him. He drew his revolver and fired twice, but missed. Abanga, one of ours, flung an assegai at him as he sat on ground and struck him in the breast. Then Kwabukana came and stabbed him, and the son of Maganga, and us others. We assegaied the other three also, including the dressive native.
When the first Zulu volley was fired, it was very much a case of every man for himself. The British patrol simply fell apart. Even the Prince Imperial, after all, was running away when he was attacked. Lieutenant Carey had ridden across the Donga and had gone for several hundred yards beyond before one of his men pointed out to him that the Prince appeared to be down and was certainly missing. At that point, there was a terrible shock amongst the party at the realization that, of all people, one of the casualties appeared to be the Prince Imperial of France.
The Prince's naked body was recovered the next morning. Chelmsford ordered a funeral service to be attended by the entire column.
Lord Chelmsford's initial reaction was to bury the body of the Prince Imperial in the field, as of course fallen British soldiers traditionally were. His staff pointed out to him that that was politically inadvisable, however, and he agreed then to send it home. And the body was carried with great procession down from the lines of communication, down through the colonial capital at Pietermaritzburg, down to Durban, where it was put on board a ship and actually sent home to England. By the time it arrived in England, the news, of course, had saturated the British press, and huge crowds gathered to greet the body when it was landed, and indeed to follow it to its final place of rest at Chislehurst in Kent, where the imperial family had lived in exile. Indeed, the sense of outrage felt by the British public over the death of the Prince Imperial was far greater than that was experienced by the disaster at Isandlwana 6 months before. Would he have gone on to become the Emperor Napoleon IV in his day? Would he, as seems far more likely, have lived out a rather empty life in exile in London, waiting for a call that never came? These issues continued to dominate certainly British and French political argument for some time after the Zulu War. But the fact remains that in terms of the campaign itself, this was a very minor incident. It was really only the celebrity of the prince itself that added any kind of interest to it at all. Similar skirmishes had gone on before in Zululand, and indeed would go on afterwards.
In Zululand, the war had moved on. By the end of June, Chelmsford's columns had advanced deep into Zululand. In the coastal districts, the 1st Division occupied the country in such numbers that for the first time, individual Zulu chiefs began to surrender. The combined 2nd Division and flying column, meanwhile, had pressed on in the face of constant skirmishing. Chelmsford's determination to secure a decisive military conclusion to the war was given an added impetus by the news that he was to be superseded.
The reasons that the British government finally lost faith in Lord Chelmsford had very little to do with his conduct of the war in the field. In fact, by the middle period of the war, there was a distinct breakdown in communications between Lord Chelmsford and the civil authorities in Natal. Much of this had to do with the use of colonial troops and certainly the escalating cost of transport and the difficulties of acquiring civilian transport from Natal. And it was actually these issues which seemed to the government in London to make it extremely difficult for Chelmsford to carry on as a commander. And as a result, the government sent out somebody to supersede him, General Sir Garnet Wolseley, very up-and-coming, thrusting young officer with a reformist attitude, very much a darling of the Victorian public, who was sent out with full civil and military powers, really to resolve these complications and actually get the war back on track.
On the 26th of June, the British came for the first time within sight of the Emakosini Valley, the sacred heartland of the Zulu Kingdom, where King Shaka's ancestors were buried. British troops scoured the valley, destroying some of the most venerable royal homesteads in the country. In one of them, unnoticed by the British, an object of great mystic significance to the Zulus went up in smoke. The inkata, a coil of grass rope, said to embody the spiritual unity of the nation. The omens for the future of the kingdom could hardly have been worse. At the end of June, Lord Chelmsford descended into the valley of the White Mfolozi River and within sight at last of Ondini itself.
As the British advance drew within striking distance of Ondini, King Cetshwayo summoned his army one last time. The Zulus took up a defensive position on the north bank of the Waitemfolosi River. The British, of course, camped on the south. And for several days there was a hiatus as Lord Chelmsford prepared for the last stage of the advance. And the Zulus, indeed, went through the necessary rituals to make one final defence of their country. It was very clear to the king himself at this stage that he was unlikely to win that battle. But the young warriors particularly still felt that they were not prepared to allow the British in without one last gesture of defiance.
As Chelmsford prepared for his final confrontation with the Zulu army, his successor, Sir Garnet Wolseley, arrived in southern Africa. But deep in Zululand, Chelmsford was largely beyond Wolseley's control. And while Wolseley was held up by a rough sea off the Zululand coast, Chelmsford hurried to claim his final victory. On the 3rd of July, Chelmsford sent Buller's irregular cavalry to scout across the Waitemfolosi to search for a good place to fight. They were skillfully ambushed by the Zulus and only just managed to escape. That night, both sides made their preparations for the battle to come.
Their noise was something terrible. All our camp was astir, sentries on outposts extra vigilant, and to hear the discordant yells and shrieks, one would have thought pandemonium had released all fiends. Very few slept, and during the whole night this yelling continued, the demons coming even to the opposite side of the river, some 300 yards from our camp. I cannot describe the unnatural singing and noise of that night, but some of our natives inform me it was their last feast prior to engaging us, that if we did not move out to attack them, they would certainly attack us in camp.
At dawn the following morning, Lord Chelmsford crossed the Waitemfolosi at the head of the largest concentration of British troops to take the field during the war.
The army that Lord Chelmsford took across the river to fight the final battle within sight of Ondini was the largest concentration of British firepower yet assembled in southern Africa. It included several batteries of artillery, 2 Gatling machine guns, the largest concentration of Imperial regular infantrymen that had yet fought in a single battle. By contrast, the Zulus, whose total numbers were still in the region of 20,000, were an army which had been weakened repeatedly by a series of costly defeats. So by the time that the Battle of Ulundi took place, there's a distinct shift in the military balance in favour of the British. Lord Chelmsford now has the upper hand, and the Zulus are fighting very much on their back foot.
Beyond the Umfolozi, Chelmsford formed his men into a square. Screened by cavalry, they marched to a low rise selected by Buller the day before.
Buller's horse, on ahead, soon came in contact with the enemy and opened the bore, and drew them on by steadily retreating fighting until the Zulus, showing up very strong and determinedly on all sides, compelled him to canter back to the square and thus enabled the infantry to become engaged. On came the enemy, and the great fight commenced in earnest, and for the 3/4 of an hour that it lasted, it was as disagreeable as one could wish for. The air seemed alive with the whistling of bullets and slugs and pieces of cooking pot legs fired from elephant guns as they came banging in amongst us from all directions. I ran down to where the 21st and 58th regiments were heavily engaged with some Zulus, said to be 6,000 strong and 30 deep, who were charging, and it was then that I heard Lord Chelmsford say to the troops, "Men, fire faster! Can't you fire faster?" However, the Zulus who charged this corner did not succeed in breaking it. The terrific fire of our men made them stagger, halt, and fall back in a straggling mass, leaving a heap of dead and dying on the ground.
After the battle was over, some of the men of Wood's flying column, who'd faced the Zulus at the Battle of Kambula, suggested that the Zulu attacks at Ulundi weren't so as intense as they had been in the earlier battles. There may have been some truth to this. Certainly the repeated hammer blows of the earlier battles had begun to sap the Zulu confidence. Even the extraordinary bravery of the Zulu warriors was beginning to falter by the time they had to face the concentrated British firepower here at Ulundi. Yet to some extent, this was a political element introduced by the flying column to play up their own victory at Kambula and play down Lord Chelmsford's victory at Ulundi. In fact, the war correspondent Melton Pryor who'd witnessed some of the Zulu attacks from inside the square here, walked over to the line afterwards and paced out to where the nearest Zulu bodies lay. He found that the nearest Zulus had died just 10 paces from the British line.
When the Zulu attacks began to falter, Lord Chelmsford ordered his cavalry, the 17th Lancers and Irregulars, to chase them from the field.
In one movement, the lances dropped to the right side of the horses' necks, the steel heads pointing straight at the mass of retreating Zulus. As the big horses bounded forward and thundered into them, each lance point pierced the Zulu in front of it. The man fell, and as the horse passed on beyond him, the lance was withdrawn, lifted, and thrust forward into another Zulu in front.
The Anglo-Zulu War remained a war without prisoners to the very end.
So ended the fight at Ulundi. We all at once crowded around to congratulate the chief. The soldiers cheered the generals, and everyone rejoiced. Our total loss was 1 officer and 10 men killed, 19 officers and 69 men wounded, 28 horses killed and 45 wounded. The Zulus, whose total strength that day was certainly over 20,000, were estimated to have lost 1,500.
Chelmsford allowed his officers to ride to Ondini, and after looting it of curiosities, they set it on fire. Every royal homestead within reach of the troops was destroyed. The heart of the Zulu kingdom was reduced to ashes.
There is an argument which says that the Battle of Ulundi, as the British called it, was unnecessary from a strategic point of view, that it was actually clear to both sides that the war was really already over and that the British had won. Yet that rather misses the point that both sides needed to have that message underlined. The British needed to prove their victory, and the Zulus needed to make their last gesture in defense of their homeland. Once the battle was over, however, it was very clear to the majority of the population of Zululand, very quickly, that the fighting was over and that the Zulus had lost.
For Lord Chelmsford, the Battle of Ulundi was a personal vindication that wiped clean the stain of defeat at Isandlwana. Within days of the victory, he had resigned his command. Sir Garnet Wolseley was welcome to what remained of the war. King Cetshwayo himself had not stayed to witness the battle. He had listened to the noise from a distance, and when the first defeated warriors passed him, he covered his head with his cloak in despair. Then he quietly walked away. For 2 months, the British pursued him, until on the 28th of August, he was captured by British dragoons at a remote homestead in northern Zululand. He was taken under heavy escort to Wolseley's camp at Ondini.
Already by the time King Cetshwayo arrived in Sir Garnet Wolseley's camp near the burnt-out ruins of the old Ondini homestead, Wolseley had decided that he was going to send the king into exile. There was no place for him in the new British-run scheme of things in Zululand. And King Cetshwayo was sent down to Port Durnford on the Zululand coast to be loaded into a steamer and shipped off to exile in Cape Town, where, it was hoped, he would be away from Zululand and all influence on Zulu politics thereafter.
The Anglo-Zulu War was over. For the Zulus, the reality of defeat was already obvious.
It shines in the eyes of all the people. The Zulu is tired. The black elephant trumpets to the wind, and no one trembles. No longer will the earth shake, for his feet will not tread upon it. The bones of our kings are crumbling. Nothing but death conquers the white man.
The war had cost the lives of nearly 2,000 British troops and their African allies in action, while more than 300 died of disease. The British exchequer had paid out over £5 million. At least 8,000 Zulus had died defending their country, and thousands more were badly injured. The king was deposed, the great centers of royal authority razed to the ground. Hundreds of ordinary civilian homesteads had been burnt, and thousands of cattle carried away by the victors. Had it all been worth it?
The invasion of Zululand, of course, had been very much a part of the whole British forward policy that was implicit in the program of confederation that had died to a large extent on the battlefield of Isandlwana when all sorts of political questions were raised about the confederation policy. Once the war was over, the British government was very keen to withdraw from Zululand as quickly as possible, and hence the idea to divide it up amongst client kingdoms who would serve British interests without actually involving British administrators, taxation, or troops. These were men who were appointed by Sir Garnet Wolseley partly on the basis that they represented the old pre-Shaka kingdoms. There was a very real sense of trying to break Zululand up into its component parts, but that ignored the impact that the Zulu royal house had had on the country over a period of 60 years. And in fact, what happened was that these appointees were often largely regarded as traitors by the people that they were set to rule over.
He fought here against the British, but afterwards the people have turned and say, no, we have fought at Isandlwana, so I want my own land. But not even a piece of a land. He was actually wanted to be a king, which is wrong.
The new Zulu elite reacted firmly to any sign of support for the old order. Less than a year after the invasion, Zulu royalists appealed to the British to intervene on their behalf. They were to be bitterly disappointed.
The British colonial authorities in Natal remained implacably opposed to the Zulu royal house. There was a very strong feeling that actually it was the Zulu royal house which was behind the whole threat posed to British interests, allegedly, by the Zulu kingdom, and a feeling that therefore they should support those who were opposed to the resurgence of the Zulu royal house. All this did effectively was bolster various feuding groups within Zululand and allow the royalist faction, which still commanded a terrific amount of support within the country at large, no redress for the wrongs that it felt it was suffering.
From his exile in Cape Town, King Cetshwayo once more became a factor in Zulu politics. Now that he was no longer a threat, many in Britain found it easy to romanticize his plight.
Cetshwayo's personal appearance is quite unlike any of the so-called portraits which have appeared in the pictorial press. He is an exceptionally fine specimen of the noble savage. Major Poole, his guardian, speaks favourably of his general amiability and says he has given little trouble.
Once King Cetshwayo had recovered from the shock of his defeat and exile, he actually began to play the British public quite cleverly. From his position in exile at Cape Town, he entertained a lot of quite influential tourists. He became a stopping-off point on assorted lords, ladies, gentlemen, politicians' trip round Africa. And a certain amount of sympathy for his plight was engendered, which he very carefully encouraged to sow the seed of doubt, both in the British administration at home and amongst the public at large, that there had been something fundamentally unjust about the invasion of Zululand, and that certainly the post-war policies were in need of careful consideration.
In 1882, as Wolseley's post-war settlement teetered on the brink of collapse, the Colonial Office contemplated an extraordinary reversal of policy. Cetshwayo was invited to London to discuss his restoration to Zululand.
King Cetshwayo's visit to London was very much a turning point in his rehabilitation with the Victorian public in England. They had expected to see this terrible savage, the monstrous victor of the Battle of Isandlwana, and they actually saw in their illustrated papers a very urbane, sophisticated, rather authoritative figure wearing European clothes. Large crowds gathered outside his house in Kensington every day to catch a glimpse of the king. So far from jeering him, as the king himself expected that they might, they actually cheered him when they caught sight of his demeanour and his general bearing. And he became quite a popular figure, and this then became a crucial part of his political rehabilitation into Zulu affairs. He met Queen Victoria herself, and he had a number of important meetings with the Colonial Office in which he sought to put across his view that were he restored to Zululand, he would be much more pliable and much more able to restore authority in a troubled region than the existing administration which the British had set up in 1879.
Cetshwayo returned to Zululand on the 10th of January 1883, almost exactly 3 years after the beginning of the British invasion. He was well aware of the divisions which had festered during his absence. "I did not land in a dry place," he said. "I landed in the mud. I came and found long-standing feuds and bitterly opposed enemies."
When King Cetshwayo returned to Zululand in 1883, he attempted to rebuild his old Ondini residence. It was a slightly smaller complex than the original one, undoubtedly reflecting the reduction in his power and authority. But nevertheless, it served as a center and a focus of loyalty for royalists across the country. This, of course, was widely resented by those groups whom the British, in turn, had set up during his absence. And in particular, there was a very bitter and dangerous rivalry with his old erstwhile commander, Chief Zibebu. Zibebu became the focus for anti-royalist feelings within the country. This soon led to an outbreak of violence, in which royalists initially attacked Chief Zibebu, were easily defeated by him, and Zibebu then went on to the offensive and launched a very daring counter-attack right at the new Ondini royal homestead itself.
The attack was so quick and unexpected that there was no time to properly marshal the king's men. They moved out in a disorderly manner to try and keep off the attack from the king and his kraal, which was then largely occupied by the nobility of the land and women and children. The king was urged by his councillors to get away into safety, to which he replied, "Am I to run away from my dog?" But as his men were gradually pushed back, he was prevailed on to get away.
Cetshwayo's followers were utterly routed at Ondini.
In many ways, the battle which took place here in July 1883 was the final tragedy of the Zulu War. The conflicts which were engendered by the post-war settlement imposed by the British led directly to the clash between the king and his supporters. In this battle, more of the great Zulu notables, more of the great chiefs, more of the king's Isandlwana were killed than in any of the battles of 1879. The names on this memorial are a roll call to the great ones of the old Zulu kingdom, of the old order that was finally overthrown here as a result of British intervention. They include Chief Godide, who had commanded the Zulus at the Battle of Inyezan, the first battle of the Anglo-Zulu War. Chief Nchingwayo himself, the man who had commanded at Isandlwana, the great Zulu victory over the British. Chief Sihayo, whose sons had provoked the British ultimatum in 1879. Even Vumandaba Khan Tati, one of the king's most trusted Indunas, who had received the British ultimatum in December 1878, and who had gone on to command the Ukandem Pemvu regiment at the Battle of Isandlwana. Here are the great men who had made the kingdom in King Cetshwayo's day, and here they had died as a result of the conflicts that had been engendered by the British.
The king fled to the protection of a British outpost at Eshawi. There, on the 8th of August 1884, he collapsed suddenly and died. Officially, the British attributed his death to heart disease. Privately, they believed he had been poisoned.
When King Cetshwayo died in February 1884, his supporters brought his body in an ox wagon out here to the fringes of the Nkandla forest. This was one of the most remote areas from British authority, and the fact that his supporters brought him out here was very much an expression of their discontent and their disillusion with the way that the British had handled their affairs in Zululand over the previous 5 years. When King Cetshwayo died, he was wrapped in a black ox skin, and he was buried here behind me at this spot. And the oxen that had drawn the wagon this far were slaughtered and their bodies left on the top of the grave. And the wagon that brought him out here was also left here to decay so that no one might touch it or use it thereafter. For King Cetshwayo, this was the end of the long and bitter road that had begun when he first invited Shepstone to his coronation in 1873. The royalist cause passed to his son, the young Prince Dunuzulu, who very quickly emerges as a very talented and dynamic young leader. Prince Dunuzulu brought the Transvaal Boers into the equation. Actually using their influence, using them to support his warriors, he defeated Chief Zibebu at the Battle of Echaneni, and the royalists really regained the ascendancy within Zululand. The price that they paid for this, however, was a far greater interference in their affairs by the Boers in the Transvaal and the potential loss of huge amounts of territory. This in itself at last provoked the interest of the British, who'd been quite content to let affairs in Zululand slide hitherto, but who were very reluctant to see the Boers gaining an ascendancy within the country. And in 1887, the British finally shouldered their responsibilities that they had assumed by the destruction of the Zulu kingdom in 1879 and formally took over in Zululand. That then provoked a royalist revolt on the part of Prince Dunuzulu, in which for the last time Zulu warriors armed with shields and assegais went up against British redcoats inside Zululand. was a very minor campaign. It was over after really a series of skirmishes rather than pitched battles. And at the end of it, Prince Dunuzulu was taken prisoner by the British and sent into exile on the island of St. Helena.
In the aftermath of the 1888 rebellion, Zululand was open to white settlement. Ordinary Zulus now found themselves forced by taxation to work for white masters rather than their own kings. There was to be just one last attempt to reverse the tide of white supremacy. In 1906, the imposition of a poll tax by the authorities in Natal provoked a chief named Bambatha to rebel.
What I remember, my grandfather went to the Berkeley field with the Majozi regime, and they fought, but they lose because even Bambatha has captured, even Silwane, son of Phakade, son of Chief Phakade of the Macunus at Msinga, across the Tugela River. They just disappeared.
Although the rebellion of 1906 actually started in colonial Natal rather than Zululand proper, and owed its origins to a very specific set of grievances against colonial rule, there was a sense in which it sought to draw on the heroic traditions of the Zulu royal house. When Chief Bambatha fled into Zululand, one of the few Zulu chiefs who actually rose to support his rebellion was our old friend Mehluka Zulu. He was the son of Sehayo, who had provoked Freya's ultimatum so many years before, and who had fought throughout the War of 1879. And the coming together of these two individuals represented a number of threads which had in common a rejection of colonial authority and of white intervention in cultural affairs. In fact, of course, the times had changed greatly since 1879. There would be no great victories like Isandlwana in the 1906 rebellion. Both Chief Bambatha and Mehluka Zulu himself were caught, along with their warriors, in a gorge known as the Morme, where they were largely slaughtered by colonial troops armed with Maxim machine guns and quick-firing artillery. The complex and interdependent relationship between Natal and Zululand, which had really existed since the arrival of the first white settlers in King Shaka's time, and which had so often led to bloodshed and violence, had at last come full circle and led to the dispossession of the very people who had allowed the British to arrive in the area in the first place.
From the point of view of those who have experienced two world wars with their widespread bloodshed and devastation, the story of the Zulu War of 1879 reads like that of a series of skirmishes carried on in an unimportant country for obscure reasons. Yet to the Zulu people, it was the ultimate tragedy, involving as it did loss of independence, of self-government, and of freedom to live their lives as seemed best to them.